Richard Max Tafoya.
Thank you very much, Your Honors. Devin Burstein on behalf of Mr. Tafoya. Your Honors, this is a case about an overbroad travel ban. Under this court's precedent and section 3583D2, supervised release conditions are permissible if they involve no greater deprivation of liberty than is reasonably necessary for the purposes of supervised release. Here, the blanket oral restriction on travel to Mexico involved a greater deprivation of liberty than was reasonably necessary. And we know that in...
Mr. Bernstein, yes, I don't believe you objected to that, or whoever was your client's representative. So in United States versus Wolfchild and other cases, we've reviewed for plain error the argument that the district court erroneously imposed supervised release conditions burdening particularly significant liberty interests. Why shouldn't we review this for plain error?
There's two reasons. Well, the first response is in many white horses, as I cited to the court held to quote, although many white horses did not raise this argument at the time of sentencing, we reviewed de novo the legal authority of the district court to impose the condition. So that's answer number one. Answer number two is even if you review for plain error, the outcome should be the same. This shouldn't be a case, Your Honor, dictated by the standard of review. So regardless of how this court ultimately comes out, if it follows Whitehead or does not, sorry, not Whitehead, many white horses, or it does not, the outcome should be the same. The remand.
What case establishes the right to international travel while a liberty interest is a particularly significant one? What's your best case on that issue?
Again, two answers to that. So I think Enrique would be the, and Kent versus Dulles would be the best case. But again, let me just pause. Let's just say the court disagrees that it's a significant, particularly significant liberty interest. We still prevail, Your Honor, under the plain language of 3583D2. So take out for a second, Your Honor. Let's just assume the court disagrees that it's a particularly significant liberty interest. And it's just a standard constitutional liberty interest, however we want to define that. And it's an amorphous term. It doesn't matter because 3583D2, still says it can involve no greater deprivation of liberty than reasonably necessary. So that's the baseline. So we know that this condition involved a greater deprivation of liberty than necessary. And we know that in many ways, but the easiest and most straightforward way to resolve this case is to say, the district judge issued a written condition that allowed for an exception with probation. This court has repeatedly focused on that allowance to find a condition narrowly tailored.
But counsel, your client had, I believe, in a 6-month period, crossed the border from Mexico 79 times. I might be a little bit off on the period of time. He admitted on a number of those occasions, he had transported drugs. He set somebody else to transport drugs. There are at least suggestions in the pre-sentence report that the government viewed his involvement as far more extensive. Why would it be greater deprivation than normal for the district court to say, we're going to just cut out Mexico here? And when you get out of jail, basically, that's going to take away a big possibility of you're just committing more crimes. Given the record here, why was this more than was reasonably necessary?
Because all what was reasonably necessary is a prohibition with an allowance for probation to grant exceptions. And that was reasonably necessary for everything that Your Honor just noted. This is somebody who had significant travel and ties.
His ties, though, he claims to have a girlfriend in Mexico, but I noticed he has a fiance in the United States, and the whole rest of his family's in the United States. So, and the girlfriend, I'm sure probably his fiance is happy that the judge banned him from going to Mexico, but that's neither here nor there. But the girlfriend seems to be involved in drugs, is the one that recruited him and all of that. So it just doesn't, you know, he wouldn't be prevented from, if some circumstance came up, that he could go to the court to say that there was some really legitimate reason to go to Mexico. But all of his reasons in Mexico have been, whether it was 79, 73, over 6 months or whatever, that's Mexico was where he dealt drugs and mules.
Well, let's look at the conditions themselves, Your Honor. So the oral condition says at ER 56, Mr. Tafoya is not to go into Mexico for any reason. The written condition says not enter or reside in the Republic of Mexico without permission of the court or probation officer and comply with both United States and Mexican immigration law requirements.
Let me ask you, with those two statements there, do you think it would just be permissible for us to send it back and say, look, there's some ambiguity here, just clean it up?
Exactly. I think that's exactly what this court, this case law calls for. I mean, that's exactly the right remedy.
I think you both agreed, though, that the oral, I think the government agrees that the oral controls here. So we have to review it for the broadest, is my understanding, right?
There's no require. We agree the oral controls, and that's what I think Judge Paez was getting at. Was yeah. Because the oral controls and but then subsequently he entered a more tailored written condition. How is this, you know, it's a little difficult for this court, and there was no explanation of the oral. I think, not to put words in your mouth, Judge Paez, but I understood that question to be saying, how do we know what the court really wanted to do when it imposed a written condition that's more narrowly tailored? It imposed a broad oral condition.
So counsel, are you sort of abandoning the argument in your briefs that the oral condition absolutely controls, and we have to take that condition on its face and decide whether it was legitimately imposed or not? I mean, the whole point of your brief struck me as being the oral condition controls, and so you should only be dealing with the oral condition.
The point of the brief that the oral condition controls is that the court can't simply say, the court could do what Judge Paez suggested, but couldn't do, we are going to construe the oral provision, or we're going to interpret the oral condition as somehow incorporating the written condition. They're not close enough for that to happen. So that's why
without coming here, could you have asked for a court date to come in and say, Your Honor, could you clarify?
No, unfortunately, we could not come back to court because this is not that type of error. This is not the type of error that's just a scrivener's error.
You could go back and ask, because this was a special condition of probation, of supervised release. At some point, you could go back to the district court and ask the district court to modify the terms and conditions of supervised release. That's always permissible.
Right. That's true. That is permissible.
You could ask the judge, and you could point to the judge and say, hey, look, you know, all we want is just authorization to go to travel to Mexico, and like the judgment, the conditions of supervised release modified to allow for that.
Right, but you're
on the district. When I was a district judge, I got many of those requests from prisoners who had been released and wanted their terms and conditions of supervised release modified to accommodate changed circumstances.
Right, and Your Honor, but that same response applies to this the massive amount of this court's supervised release condition jurisprudence. When they're raised on appeal, the answer from the court could always be, we're not going to hear, you know, we're not going to deal with this residency restriction, this computer restriction, this familial restriction. We're just going to wait till you get out of custody and then go back and ask for the judge to change it.
That's correct. But you suggested that you couldn't ask for a modification, but you can. My only question was, should we, given what he said, what the judge said on the bench, and obviously when he looked over the judgment, the written judgment, and approved it, somebody added extra language. And so, obviously, to me, there's an ambiguity, and I would just send it back and say, clarify what you intended to do here.
I agree that that's the proper remedy. I mean, in fact,
Let me ask you this. If we did the judge said, what I meant was you can't go to Mexico, then if we just send it back and that's what the judge says, then we'll be right back here unless we pass on whether the judge could do what the judge did or not.
Your Honor, what I would suggest is sending it back and doing something like in Wolfchild, where the court says, if you're going to impose, if you still decide the condition, the oral condition is necessary, tell us why. And if not, impose the written condition, because we've approved similar written conditions in Velasquez Sedano.
But to do that, we would have to find reversible error.
To do that, you could do it based on, you would find reversible error based on a number of reasons. But I think the simplest is I think it can flow very quickly and easily from 3583 D2. And you say, we know the standard is no greater than necessary. Here we have a greater oral condition and a lesser written condition. So there's no way for this court to say that it's not greater than necessary, because the district judge himself signed a condition, as Judge Pius pointed out, that was more narrowly tailored. So in this kind of circumstance, I think really the court's case law compels a remand to fix this. And it's especially true because we're talking about international travel. And whether that's fundamental or particularly significant, we know beyond all doubt it's constitutional. Second, to some degree, this does affect his First Amendment right to association. You know, Judge Callahan pointed out he has a fiance in the United States. At this point in 2021, I don't think we can assume that that necessarily means it's a monogamous relationship. We also don't know where his dentist is, his doctors are. We don't know. I mean, I just had my first root canal in Mexico. You know, there people go, especially in San Diego and Southern California, to Mexico all the time. And so to send it back for either a further explanation for a total travel ban or to impose a lesser restriction seems entirely appropriate here. It's a limited remand. It doesn't take significant time, but it does fulfill a key requirement and a key goal of our justice system, which I know
But if he clarifies it and says, I meant a total ban, then we're just going to have it right back on appeal.
I don't think that's necessarily true, Your Honor, because if he says,
tell me you're not coming back. Yeah. Well, you're not going to tell me that. You're coming back. If you don't get what you want, you're coming back. So what I see is before us, we have to decide, can the oral stand? If the oral doesn't stand, then we strike it and it goes back for that. If the oral does stand, then it's we're not reversing it. And what we're left with is to go back and ask for modifications to conditions of probation.
Can I respectfully push back Judge Callahan just a little bit on that?
Go ahead. Go do it with respect.
Thank you. So what I would suggest to the court is this, and I tried to focus on this in the briefs. It's not just the fact of the ban. It's the fact of the ban without an explanation. Every other time in every single case cited by both parties that this court has affirmed a ban, it has relied on the specific explanation of the district court and or what I'll call a safety valve for an exception for probation. So I tried to say the same thing to Judge Bennett. It's not just the fact of the condition. This court can decide that it doesn't need to rule on the scope of the condition because it's ruling on the lack of explanation. And I think that's
why do I know that he's been there more? He's been in 6 months. He's been to Mexico more times than I've been to my office. Why do I know that that there's information that his involvement is much greater than what his admissions are? How do I know all of that? And why can't I say that supports what the judge did? I mean, what other way can I look at that? And I know he doesn't have kids down there. I know his mom is here. Apparently his best friend, his mom is here, right? Even though his brother says something about that, and the judge says, well, I'm not going to get in the middle of that squabble, but everyone else in his family's here. He's a citizen, right? So it just seems like the guy's involved in a lot of drug dealing. He's been down there 73 or 79 times in 6 months, which is a lot when you consider that's 180 days. So Why isn't that enough?
It's not enough because we have this is a very experienced district court judge, right? I think at the time he was the chief judge, and we know that this is somebody, as Judge Pai has pointed out, Your Honor, who reviewed and then signed the judgment and the commitment order, which contains a different, less restrictive condition. I don't think this court can assume that he intended to impose a total ban on a constitutionally protected interest when he then, a few days later, signs a written condition that complies much more closely with what this court has directed district courts to do. I think it's an assumption that's not based in the record.
Okay. Thank you, counsel. Let's hear from the government.
Good afternoon, Your Honors, and may it please the court, Robert Miller on behalf of the United States. This court should affirm the sentence as orally pronounced on the record because no controlling authority prohibits the restriction on travel to Mexico that was imposed, the unconditional restriction, and the overall sentence was reasonable. First, procedurally, this court has said that significant liberty interests are implicated with respect to geographic limitations when those restrictions prevent the defendant from going back to his hometown and visiting or residing where he has strong family and community ties, as in Many White Horses and Watson. And in the case of associational restrictions, as
your friend on the other side, Mr. Miller, cited United States v. Many White Horses as a good case for him. And so there we reviewed de novo a previously unraised challenge to the court's authority to impose a supervised release condition. Why shouldn't we apply de novo here?
The court in Many White Horses only applied de novo review to whether the district court had authority to impose a geographic restriction at all that allegedly was going to impinge on tribal sovereignty. But there, the defendant conceded that as a general matter, the district court had authority to impose geographic and residency restrictions. Similarly, in Watson, the court announced that what it was doing with respect to the objected supervised release condition was abuse of discretion review. It reviewed de novo the argument raised by counsel that all geographic and residency restrictions under 3583D are constitutionally infirm, comparing it to this Cincinnati city ordinance that prohibited all drug arrestees from returning to wherever they were at. And the court said, no, as a general matter, these are constitutionally sound. So you have to show that there was an abuse of discretion, or in the case when you don't object, as here, you have to show that there's some controlling authority, some case that's on all fours where you get relief. And the defendant here can't do that, because there is no case in the Ninth Circuit or elsewhere that says a restriction prohibiting travel to a specific foreign country where the crime originated, where the defendant's not from and has no community ties, implicates
a girlfriend.
Well, that's right. And he didn't bother to explain on the record why that was significant to him. And that's very important. How is the judge supposed to know without the defendant objecting, and without there being any case that tells him, hey, I've got to do something more here, that special findings were warranted.
Counsel, how do you address Mr. Burstein's argument that we know for a fact in this case that it was more of a restriction than necessary because the judge actually signed a judgment that said can't go unless the probation officer allows it? So since he approved in writing a less restrictive condition, isn't Mr. Burstein right that we know here it's greater than a greater restriction than is necessary?
I'll answer that in two ways. First, the case law suggests that when there is this disparity between the oral pronouncement and the written conditions of supervised release, the oral pronouncement holds, and in Hicks and other cases, this court remanded for the sole purpose of conforming the written order to the oral pronouncement, and that's all. Theoretically, if this court were to adopt the rule that 3583D2 is overbroad or is violated in any case where a condition of supervised release the probation officer doesn't have discretion to modify that, then a whole host of cases are in violation.
But counsel, that's not my question. My question is not in the abstract about this condition. My question is, here the judge actually signed a piece of paper that said only with the permission of the probation officer. So the judge apparently thought that was a reasonable condition. And if that was a reasonable condition, why wouldn't the controlling oral pronouncement necessarily be more of a restriction than is necessary in this case, not in the abstract?
Well, I'm not sure quite how to answer your question other than that the case law says the oral pronouncement holds. And in this case, by all accounts, the judge was following the recommendation of probation, which didn't say a more limited prohibition. It recommended a blanket restriction on travel to Mexico, and the court seemed to say, yes, I agree, that's what I'm doing. And so the reasonable interpretation of this record is that the written order is the mistaken one. The court really doesn't need to get there because, as defendant already conceded in his briefs, the oral pronouncement holds.
Well, but Mr. Bernstein is proposing what seems to be a somewhat practical solution. So I want to hear from you. What are the parade of horribles if we were to engage in his practical solution from your perspective?
I don't think there's a parade of horribles from simply remanding it to ask Judge Burns if he really meant what he said. And I think he's likely to say, yes, I did mean what I said. And if not, then he'll probably...
You know, we can't speculate as to what Judge Burns was thinking when he signed the order, but that language was not, you know, it's clearly somebody put it in there, and he must have reviewed it, and he must have thought of it. I mean, it's there.
We can't speculate, no, what Judge Burns thought when at the moment he was writing that, but in a case where the probation officer says no travel to Mexico and the judge's oral pronouncement conforms to that recommendation, this court's case law says that that's enough to get over plain error review, which is where we're at here because of the defendant's failure to object. There are a whole host of cases that are similar in this regard, like Graham, where there was no procedural plain error found when the district court imposed a blanket restriction on relating to association with gang members, despite the fact that the defendant's brother was a gang member. No objection that withstood plain error review. And with respect to the substantive challenge here, Mr. Burstein's argument that you just look at the text, it's still plain error review. He still has to point to an analogous case that says 3583D2 is violated under these facts.
But another practical way to approach this would be to say, okay, and this isn't what Mr. Bernstein would be proposing, but I could see another practical way to say, okay, on this record, it is not plain error to impose this ban, but we remand it, but we note that there is a discrepancy between the oral and the written. We remand if the court wants to correct the conditions of probation. Then the court knows that it's a legal condition of if this court were to hold, it's a legal condition to ban him, but you have the option. Now, Mr. Bernstein's actually nodding, but I don't think he's really agreeing with me. But I don't want to see this again. I'm happy to see both of you, but I don't want to see the issue again. But I certainly, if I didn't mean something, I would always, you know, I think most judges would correct it if they wanted to be more permissive. But the way I see the issue presented is, can you do this? Does the record if it's under plain error or whatever review, does it support the expansive ban that still doesn't prevent the judge from modifying that?
Well, I think if this court were to remand, because defendant isn't able to show that there's a significant liberty interest, he's not able to show that any substantive right under any case here was violated. And so 3583 D2, there's no reason to review that. Then, yeah, the remand would be either conform the written order to the oral pronouncement or conform the oral pronouncement to the written order, if that's what you really meant. But either way, there's no special justification that's warranted in this case. Because he didn't object, and there's no case on all fours with this one where it says this type of defendant with so little nexus to the place where he's being restricted from has some sort of significant liberty interest where there needs to be extra justification on the record. Mr. Bernstein definitely wants the Wolf trial treatment, but at most he should get the Rudd treatment where Judge Burns says whether he thinks what he said was warranted or not. But this isn't Wolfchild. There was no prohibition of a direct familial or life partner relationship. And if he wanted to make that case, he should have objected.
Thank you. All right, Mr. Bernstein, I'll give you a minute for rebuttal.
I saw you nodding, Mr. Bernstein.
Yeah.
your sound is off, Mr. Bernstein.
Yes, thank you. I was nodding along with you, Judge Callahan, because I think we're all getting, I think this is somewhere between my 40th and 50th argument in this court. And I was nodding along because it's really a first. I've never been, I think we're almost all reaching, it's been such an enjoyable process in the sense that we're all kind of a true conversation. And I can't really disagree with very much that's being said, nor do I want to. This is a unique case in the sense that we have two striking things. We have this oral and this written, and there does need to be a practical solution. And I think Judge Callahan really just hit it on the head, which was really why I was nodding, is in my experience too, is judges want to get it right. And so if they've made a mistake, they want an opportunity to fix that mistake. And there's a practical solution that's been suggested, and I submit to the court.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Bernstein. Thank you. Counsel, thank you both, Mr. Miller, as well.
You.
And the matter is submitted at this time.